Have you ever wondered how a 34-year-old married dad of two with 50-hour work weeks and building a fitness business on the side fits diet and training into his very busy schedule? Well, if so, you're in luck because that's me. I'm the 34-year-old, and I'll show exactly what I got going on from training to diet and how I fit it into all the other life stuff going on, especially right now because as we're recording this, it's deep into the holiday season. I got a big move happening very soon, so I'm excited about that, but I'm going to break down everything inside today's episode. This is Gabe with GainsWithGabe.com. Welcome back to another episode of the Gains with Gabe podcast, and we are back. It feels so good to be back because I've really enjoyed doing these podcast episodes, and I really don't enjoy the very long gaps in between these episodes. So what we're going to be doing from here on out is every single Sunday, no matter what, whether it's a long episode, a short episode, a great episode, a not so great episode, we're going to just share it every single Sunday because I want to get back into the groove of it. It's always been a good time, like I said, so I want to keep on going and sharing all the insights that I ever have, whether I've learned in the past, share my stories of the past, what I'm learning now, sharing what I'm doing, sharing how it's going, and pretty much just the whole point of this is to share all these tips and insights so I can help people avoid all the mistakes that I made so they can get in better shape and actually achieve the goals that they have in terms of fitness and integrating it in life so you're not so focused on fitness, you're really focused on living a good life and having fitness be a part of it. Because there were times in my life where I would train a very, very long time, train hours in a day, train 5, 6, 7 days a week, and just really beat myself up and get injured more than I ever should have. And that's just not a good way to live. Like, yeah, obviously, sometimes you have goals that you really want to hit, so you put a lot of time and effort into them. And that makes sense in certain cases, but for most people, they're not trying to be world-class bodybuilders. They're not trying to be the strongest power lifter in the entire country. A lot of people just want to go ahead and just get in good shape, be strong, be healthy, and that's what it's really about here. So that's what I want to share on this podcast and everything that I know so you can get the best results possible for improving your life in the least amount of time so that way you have time to, you know, actually enjoy life. Because I don't know about you, but for me, working a very busy work schedule and then wanting to spend time with my family and going out and doing things and building this business on the side, it's like there's not much time in the day. So I want to be as efficient as possible. And that's the methodology that I have is being as efficient as possible. And I'm going to show you exactly what I got going on so you can see exactly how this works and maybe apply at least a tip or two to your own diet and training. So then that way you can get good results again without spending all the time in the world on it. So with that said, I want to get into my training, how it's been going. And lately it's kind of been evolving more towards a calisthenics style training, mainly because I'm training at home, even though I have a full squat rack and barbell and plate set with 205 pounds, I believe, 210, something like that, where I could do the big barbell lifts, maybe not crazy heavy, but enough to really get some good stimulation going. But I don't have a setup for that right now, so I've been really trying to figure out the best ways to get challenging workouts in and make progression with limited weights where I have 25-pound dumbbells, I have 30-pound dumbbells, a 15-pound kettlebell, the floor, a chin-up bar, and my body weight. And I've been able to really come out with a system that's been working really well so I can make progression. I'll break it down right here, right now for you. So I've still been doing a 3-day push-pull legs routine where, being fully transparent, I've been training between 2 and 3 times a week. Where, like, if I have a really busy work week and I'm working an hour away in that location, or if I'm working like 40 minutes away and by the time I get back, I'm really busy, then I'm gonna get dinner ready with my wife and play with our babies and do all this stuff that I want to do, doesn't leave a ton of time to go ahead and train. But the way I've been doing it has been very efficient, so then that way I can even squeeze it in. If I have to do it at 10:30 at night, I'm done before 11 o'clock. And if I can do it at 7, 7:30, 7:40, have a little bit more leeway there. But let's go ahead and break down the routine. It's very, very simple. So day one is a push day where I do 2 exercises at first. So I do a superset right out the gate, which is dumbbell chest flies, but I don't just do like flies on a bench because I don't have a bench right now. I'll actually lay on the ground and kick my hips up so it almost turns it into like a decline fly where again, my hips are up so that the angle of the chest fly is a little bit different. So it feels really, really good. And what I do with this one is I try to keep the reps relatively consistent. So I'll do between 10 and 12 reps and keep that steady, where I focus on the second exercise more. So the second exercise is push-ups. So after I do my set of flies, I immediately go into push-ups. And normally I could do between like 30 and 40 push-ups consistently, like all the way down, all the way up, really, really pushing towards it. But after doing the flies, since I'm already fatiguing the chest and a little bit of the shoulders beforehand, I'm getting like 10 to 12 reps. And it seems like it's like really humbling. Like it's, you go ahead and do push-ups, a simple exercise when you built up the strength for like bench press for years, and then you're only doing like 10 to 12 reps. It's kind of a mental game more than anything, but it's pretty cool because now I'm making push-ups more challenging by doing the flies immediately before that, so I can go ahead and focus on progressing. And that's why I want to keep the flies at a consistent rep range, so I can go ahead and push those reps from 10 to 12 to like 12 to 15, 15 to 20, 25 to 30, like really, really push the push-ups up, and then I can increase the reps on the flies and kind of build my way back up again. And it's a really cool way to make progress, even with just basic chest flies and push-ups. And that's what I've been doing. Eventually I can do like feet elevated push-ups or just kind of make that harder as well. But I'm not going to focus on that so much right now, because the next exercise is something that is a little bit more challenging, but it's still a push-up variation, which is pike push-ups. Now, originally I was doing shoulder press in lieu of this, but I found that I get a lot more shoulder stimulation from the pike push-ups because it's a lot more weight than like a 30-pound dumbbell. And that's pretty cool because I'll go ahead and make progressions with that too, where the further your feet are away from each other, where you're turning yourself into like a triangle essentially, the further your feet away, the easier it is. So you can kind of inch your way inward a little bit more and more as you're learning the pike push-up and getting better at it, to the point where your hands and feet are pretty close together and you get a lot of tension on the shoulders as you're coming down and coming up and essentially doing a push-up where you're almost in like a handstand position, where eventually you could, I guess you could progress towards doing a handstand push-up, which would be really, really challenging. And then maybe do like weighted handstand push-ups and like one arm handstand push-ups on one finger, kind of like Dragon Ball. That's the natural progression of that exercise, I guess. So it's been really cool. It's been experimentation with that, but I think I'm going to stick with that for a long term, at least like 8 to 12 weeks, to see how good I can get at them. Because right now I'm doing like 7-8 reps per set, which isn't a lot, but I'll go ahead and get more and more reps as time goes on. The next exercise I do on push day is what I like to call tricep push-ups. I think there's probably another name for them. Essentially, you're laying down in a you're in a push-up position, and then you're on your forearms instead of your palms, right? So your forearms are flat on the ground, and then you essentially do a tricep extension into a push-up position. And then you come down slow onto your forearms again, and you push up again. Now, the first time I tried this, I could barely do one janky rep. And then the second time, I could do 2 janky reps. And then the third time, I could do 3 janky reps, but they were getting better, less janky, more quality, and able to do more and more over time. So I want to build this up to like the 10 to 12 rep range. And you can actually play with the position of your elbows in order to make it more challenging or easier. And then making that more challenging over time will, you know, make it more challenging and get more benefit from it. Even though it's such a simple exercise, you're just pushing up to your hands and then back to your forearms. And it's such a challenging one in the beginning. So I'm going to be building that one up. And then last and definitely not least is lateral raises. Probably one of my favorite is shoulder exercises, where you do a lateral raise, side lateral raise, and really hit the side delts with that. Because the side delts and a little bit of the rear delts are not really hit with a lot of exercises. So I'm glad I'm doing those still, because I really enjoy them. And that's it. That's the push day. So I do flies and push-ups superset, pike push-ups, tricep push-ups, and the lateral raises. And then I take a day of rest, or maybe 2, depending upon the week, and then go into pull day, which I'm essentially just doing chin-ups, as many reps as I can, trying to get those up to 20 reps. I really, really want to get up to 20 reps. Best set I've ever done was 17 reps, and they were not the best range of motion. They're probably like 80% reps. I have a video of them from 2018. I can pull it from the archives, but they're about 80%, and I was able to do that many reps, 17 reps. So I want to build that up to 20 full range of motion reps, which is going to be really challenging, but I'm going to keep pushing until I can do that. Then I follow that up with a superset of dumbbell rows, bent over dumbbell rows, two hands at a time. So I'm really doing like I'm standing, bending over, and doing the rows that way, and then doing an immediate superset with dumbbell shrugs. It's only 30-pound shrugs, not a lot of weight, but it works out pretty well because if you do them immediately after rows, you already activated the traps quite a bit. You really, really feel it as long as you're contracting right, doing it nice, slow, and controlled, and really squeezing hard. You can get a fair amount out of them because my upper traps have been growing more than they ever have before, even though I'm only doing the light shrugs. And then after that, I'll do a superset of curls where I'll start in the hammer curl position, rotate on the way up, palms up at the top, slow all the way down, palms up, and then start again, reset it, do it again and again, doing both hands at the time to save time. And then immediately following with kettlebell face pulls with the 15 to really get a good squeeze and contraction, make sure I'm pulling to that eyebrow level and really hitting the rear delts and the upper traps. And then that's it, that's the pull day. And then leg day is a lot more simple. I do a superset of goblet squats and dumbbell Romanian deadlifts. And then I'll do split squats. So it's like lunges, but you're stationary because I don't have a ton of room again, but making it work. And those are really challenging, a lot more challenging than the supersets of squats and deadlifts, but it's been really nice. I've been feeling a lot in the quads and a little bit of the hamstrings and quite a bit in the glutes. It's very, very good exercise. Highly recommend trying it if you haven't already. And do not, under any circumstances, get yourself into doing Bulgarian split squats. That's a whole different discussion that I do not want to have. Nobody likes that exercise, and you don't need to do it. That's all I have to say about that. Split squats, regular split squats are the way to go, though. And then follow that up with calf raises, which I feel like is just a waste of energy because I did calf raises for a solid year where I was doing straight leg and bent leg calf raises to target each side of the calves. Didn't really make any kind of muscle gains with that. And then I stopped doing it for 4 years and my calves didn't look any different. I don't know, maybe it's just me, maybe I was doing them wrong, or maybe I just can't grow my calves. We'll see. Or maybe we won't, because I may not do this long term. But anyway, that's leg day. It's very solid, very simple, straightforward, straight to the point. And that's it. Just do it 2 to 3 days a week, ideally three. Focus on getting better every single session and making progress, like adding reps, adding weight when it makes sense to do so, and just keeping on putting all the effort I possibly can into each session. Even though they are short and sweet, they are very intense and very tough. But as long as I go ahead and put all the effort in behind it and push better for next time, you can keep making progress even with this at-home training style. It's really, really cool. Now moving on to the diet, it's incredibly simple. I use my FitnessPal to track my calories. At this current moment, I'm eating about 2,500 calories a day, sometimes a little bit less, sometimes a little bit more, but on average, right about 2,500 calories, hitting 120 grams of protein, and then the rest, don't really care. Like if I have more fats one day, don't really care. If I have more carbs one day, don't really care, because as long as I have the 2,500 calories, the 120 grams of protein, and only eat foods that make me feel good, regardless of really what they are, as long as I hit those other two stipulations, then I know I'm on the right track. So for example, if I eat a fried chicken sandwich, don't really feel good. Shouldn't do that. So I don't really do that. However, if I eat, no joke, this is not a joke, if I eat a steak quesadilla from Taco Bell, as well as the Fiesta veggie burrito, I feel solid. I feel good. I don't know what it is. It's literally Taco Bell, but I feel good eating that. Yet, fried chicken sandwich, no. So I think the important thing here is knowing what you feel good eating, because a lot of times they're like, oh, this health food is the best, but then you eat it and you don't feel good, versus like another food that's supposedly healthy that you eat and you feel good. So I know a lot of people, they can't eat chicken unless they, like, without feeling unwell. So you probably shouldn't eat a bunch of chicken, even if it is on most diet plans, because it doesn't make you feel good, versus like beef or whatever else you want to eat. Just, I think that's a really important factor to consider. And ever since I really started considering that, like I stopped eating oats because that made my mouth hurt. So I stopped doing that and I feel a lot better. Life overall has been a lot better when I've been focusing on that. But I will say the bulk of my diet lately has been chicken tenderloins specifically. I don't know what it is. I just like how they're smaller, easy to pack into meals, easy to cut up, easy to turn into my own tenders with just simply olive oil and breading. And really, really versatile food and very, very high protein, low calorie, and you can mix it into pretty much any kind of meal. Beyond that would be whole eggs, large eggs, of course, Greek yogurt bowls where I'll have like strawberry Greek yogurt with blueberries and honey nut Cheerios. That's been absolutely delicious. I'll have things like cheddar cheese. I've been having a ton of English muffins. All these foods make me feel really good, so I keep eating them, and then I can combine them in different ways too. Like I could have a chicken tenderloin cheese like a griddle sandwich kind of thing, or I can, you know, like have just a grilled cheese on an English muffin, or I can have egg and cheese on an English muffin, or I can have chicken and eggs, or I can have like lately we've also been having like Angus tip steak tips, and those have been really good. There's a bunch of different cuts that I like, and then a lot that I don't, but we've been having a lot of beef. We've been having some ground beef. Like there's a lot of different things you can have, and just making sure that they fit in the calories and protein goal for your specific goal. So like when I'm trying to lose weight or get leaner, then I eat about 2000 to 2100 calories, not 2500. But that's for me as a 5'11", 160 pound man who is relatively active and trains 2 to 3 days a week and walks a fair amount of steps. So I know my numbers. You kind of have to figure that out for yourself. And the best way I've found is like using MyFitnessPal to kind of get a baseline and seeing how your body reacts after a couple weeks of being pretty strict with it. But that's the whole diet thing. Just track everything, whether it's drinks, condiments, foods, of course, everything that you consume, track it and see where you're at. Because you kind of be surprised if you haven't done this before, you'll be surprised how much things add up. Like 2 servings of barbecue sauce is 140 calories. If you're eating 1800 calories a day, that's almost 10% of your calories in just barbecue sauce. Kind of crazy. So that's what I do for diet. And then as far as like fitting this all into life, what I essentially do is just make sure I do the fundamentals every single day. And the fundamentals are tracking my calories and training on days that it makes sense. For me, Wednesdays and Sundays are days that I have off. So I'll make sure I train on those days. And then if I have to fit it on a work day, I'll make sure I train at a time that makes sense, like when my wife and daughter's gone to sleep, or maybe my toddler's up still, and then I'll train and kind of involve her with it. And she likes watching and getting into it, and she'll do squats throughout, whether it's like leg day or chest day or pull day, or like doesn't matter what day it is, she just likes doing the squats as I'm doing exercise. It's pretty cool to see. I love seeing that. But that's pretty much how I do it. That's how I lay it out. And I squeeze it in when I can, and I don't really stress about it. Because in the past, when I was going ahead and doing very, very serious workouts, and it was really, really important to me because I want to get as strong, as jacked as possible, I would stress out if I was ever had to like miss a workout. Like I'd go do something else, like hang out with friends or whatever, and I'd be like, oh dang, I didn't work out today. I'm going to lose progress, and I'm going to end up fat again, and it's just not going to be good. I can't miss it. And then now that I've been doing this for a long time, I've realized like, you can even take 6 weeks off and still not lose hardly any progress as long as you're consistent for the rest of the year. Like it's not that serious. And unless it's serious, I'm not telling you how to think. What I mean here is like, it's not gonna be the end of the world if you miss a workout. Diet, on the other hand, is a little bit more particular because you can easily blow out 2 weeks worth of progress in one day with a really good cheat day at like Cheesecake Factory and like McDonald's and donuts and ice cream. You can blow out 2 weeks of progress like that. But with training, you can have a little bit more lax on it as long as you're working out really, really hard. And I'm not trying to suggest that you don't take it seriously. What I'm trying to suggest is that you can be at ease knowing that as long as you're making progress and as long as you're sticking to the diet, you can really achieve pretty much any fitness goal just by doing those two main things. But if you want to take it more seriously and get those results faster, that's when you be a little bit more rigid, stand up for your own goals and not let people walk over you and tell you, oh, you don't need to do that. You look fine the way you are. If you don't feel like you look fine the way you are, then nothing else anyone says matters. You got to do this for you. And like, I'm not trying to be a preacher here or anything like that. What I mean is like, you got to do what you want. So I'm really just saying what you already know. And all you really have to do is go ahead and do it. So before my camera runs out of battery, I'm gonna wrap up this episode. So hopefully you enjoyed this. Hopefully you found it helpful. Hopefully you could just take an insight from how I do things and apply it to your own diet and training. If you do want more structure that you can follow, you go ahead and join my daily email newsletter at gainswithgabe.com because I give a free guide to all new subscribers. And I also give you an invite link to my community where I have more free guides as well as you can figure out how to access my in-depth paid program where I walk you through the exact workout routines, whether you're at home or at the gym. I give you the diet plan. I break down how to figure out calories, how to learn all these things so you can apply them to whatever training style you like, whatever diet style you like. You don't have to eat particular foods in my diet plan. You can eat literally whatever you want. Obviously, again, considering calories, protein, and how food makes you feel. And it gives you the mindset hacks to kind of keep you sticking with it, even when things feel tough, where your mind starts playing tricks on you so that you kind of almost convince yourself to not do things when you know you should. And I kind of give you the frameworks on how to think about things like that so you can keep going and keep making the progress that you want, as well as other insights with like supplements and cardio and all this other stuff. It's all in that community. So when you go ahead and join, you can get access to that all completely for free, at least the base level. And then of course you can upgrade to the program, and I have coaching offers in there as well every so often. So with that said, thank you so much for being here. I do appreciate it. Any questions, definitely let me know, and I will talk to you next time.